I'm going to talk about some recent developments in redshift surveys, where by redshift survey I mean three-dimensional mappings of the universe where the transverse coordinates are angles and the radial coordinate is the redshift. Traditionally, this has always been the redshift of a galaxy, although I'm going to talk a little bit about things that maybe don't exactly fall into that category. So there's been three what I think are exciting new ideas in the last year. Really, a lot of times I think, you know, ideas come up and then 30 years later they finally are useful. But these are things that have really changed the way I look at large-scale structure and changed it very quickly. Two of them are from SEMA. So the first one is an idea by Su Cheng and Wei Li to map 21 centimeter emission to make the redshift survey. This is where the not exactly galaxies comes in. Make a redshift survey by just mapping the intensity of redshift to 21 centimeter emission from all the neutral gas essentially in the universe instead of trying to identify individual objects. And this potentially could make mapping the whole universe an efficient process instead of something that we could only hope to do in the distant future. Another new idea, pretty much independent, although they're coupled in the sense that the first one makes the second one more possible and interesting, was Neil, Dalal, and Olivier, and others, thought up a new method to detect primordial non-Gaussianity in the large-scale structure power spectrum. And the third was an idea by, or Seljak, somewhat motivated by Dalal et al., how to use multiple galaxy types with different bias to be cosmic variance. So, and again, the 21 centimeter intensity mapping works. It will help this kind of thing a lot. So, first I'm going to talk, just give a very brief summary of current and planned large scale structure surveys, including this 21 centimeter emission mapping. Then talk about non-Gaussianity and some new subtleties of bias. A lot of this is related to subtleties of bias that we didn't really think of before. And finally, redshift space distortions that make the constraining power of what we thought of as varying acoustic oscillation surveys to constrain dark energy, these galaxies, planned galaxy surveys, make them much more powerful than just the DAO alone. This is related to the Seljak idea, which he originally came up with to do non-Gaussianity, but then I've been doing some work related to redshift space distortions. So the basic picture of large-scale structure, just to make sure everyone is on the same page, is that inflation or whatever produces, or the model predicts, a spectrum of small perturbations in the very early universe. We can measure these while they're still very small using the cosmic microwave background. They continue to grow through gravitational instability, so the fluctuations become relatively large and nonlinear on small scales where galaxies form. But on large scales, the fluctuations are still close to linear, and we measure them by observing the large scale density field of galaxies or other things which trace the mass. So here's the famous W map, CMB map, which shows you the perturbations at a redshift of 1,000. This is the best cosmological probe, certainly, because the perturbations are truly linear, and so the theory is relatively simple. This is a very precise W map CMB power spectrum. This is the kind of thing we'd like to have for all large scale structure. And there's good reason to think that we will essentially have this kind of precision with low redshift galaxy surveys. So the motivation beyond the CMB is the foundation for all of our precision cosmology measurements, but it can't do everything, especially since dark energy, which is the whatever is making the universe accelerate recently, well, happened recently. So after the CMB, CMB can only probe it a little bit indirectly. So we'd like to have surveys that span the full redshift range from now back, if possible, all the way to the CMB, although, as I'll show, our current surveys only probe a very limited range of redshift very nearby. So we would like to constrain dark energy, and most of the focus lately has been doing on this through varying acoustic oscillations, but there's lots of other ideas people have had, and lots of other effects people have had that are still there, and I'm going to talk mostly about those instead of the variant acoustic oscillations that most large-scale structure talks will be about recently. One's the redshift space distortions. So remember, the redshift of the galaxy gives us a radial coordinate for the galaxy because of the Hubble flow, which galaxies are moving away from us, and the speed increases as proportional to how far away they are, and so that redshift gives us a radial coordinate. But there's peculiar velocities, so deviations. The galaxies have velocities relative to the Hubble flow, and those give basically, they're relatively small compared to the speed of light, so they give essentially a Doppler shift, which changes the redshift space position of the galaxy relative to its Hubble flow, its true position. The redshift space distortions produce, that happens only radially, and that distorts any correlation function you measure for these galaxies along your line of sight, distorts it relative to transverse to the line of sight. And you can use that to probe how the structure is evolving. What created these peculiar velocities, essentially, which is a source of gravity, but how much mass there was in the universe. Also, geometric effects. So we measure an angle on the sky, but in the transverse direction. But that isn't a distance either, right? The redshift isn't a real distance. The angle isn't a real distance. We need to know the geometry of the universe, which is predicted by a model for the background evolution. And we'll relate that angle to an actual distance. And so by measuring the structure, then so there's other things. The Schrödinger scale of the power spectrum gives us a measure of the matter density. Neutrino masses affect the power spectrum. Inflation predicts, different inflation models predict different power spectra, which we can measure those deviations, those differences. The initial perturbations aren't necessarily perfectly Gaussian, and we can measure that. Gravity isn't necessarily general relativity. So there's lots of things we can measure. And what makes this so exciting, which I kind of only really came to realize recently, was how little we've actually done so far. This shows the cumulative volume of the universe up to some redshift. And the biggest galaxy redshift survey we have, it's the Sloan, the biggest well sampled survey, is the Sloan luminous red galaxies, which sample about 1 cubic gigaparsec out to about redshift 0.35 to 0.4. As you can see here, that's essentially a minuscule fraction of the total volume of the universe out to even redshift 5. There's actually a lot more co-moving volume at higher redshift. And this matters because the number of Fourier modes, the statistical power of the survey, is proportional to the volume of the survey. It's actually the truth, and I haven't had a chance to make a figure of this yet, is that the truth is much more extreme than this, because not only as you go to higher redshift do you get more volume, but nonlinearity is weaker. The perturbations are closer to linear, and the scale where, so remember, large scales are linear, small scales are nonlinear. The scale for that transition is smaller at larger redshift. That means that in any co-moving volume, there's a lot more individual patches on that nonlinear scale. So another way of saying this is the maximum K wave number where you can use a Fourier mode for precision cosmology is larger at higher redshift. And that means that this goes up. That K is larger proportional to the growth factor, proportional to the expansion factor, roughly. So say K is 4 times larger, the K max, the nonlinear K is about 4 times larger at redshift 3 than it would be at redshift 0. And the number of modes you have, because the universe, Fourier modes you have, because the universe is three-dimensional, it's proportional to K max cubed, which means you get a factor of 4 higher K max, you really have a factor of 4 cubed, or 64 times more information, beyond all of the extra volume that you have. So we've done a very good approximation to nothing so far, relative to what we can do. So I've been talking about the power spectrum and not necessarily explained what it is. Just suppose, just in case anyone doesn't know this, suppose you have some field F of V, where V in the radial direction is a velocity, in the transverse direction, it's a three-dimensional vector, transverse direction, it's an angle. So say it's the density of galaxies, although it could also be this 21 centimeter intensity, or when I made this slide, it was multiplying alpha force absorption in physics vector. Usually we will divide it by the mean and subtract 1, so this has is the fractional fluctuation around the mean. The power spectrum is the variance, the square of the amplitude of Fourier mode. So your Fourier transform is 3D field, and power spectrum amplitude of those, typical amplitude on a given scale given by K, which is 2 pi over the wavelength of the Fourier mode. That's power spectrum. And if you like this better, it's also the Fourier transform of the correlation function, which is just if you have the field fluctuation of x and then the field fluctuation of some distance away r, what is the product of these two? So if they're highly correlated, then that number should be positive because we are either positive or negative together. Anyway, the power spectrum is the Fourier transform of the correlation function. And this shows the linear theory power spectrum that standard lambda CDM models with inflation predicts, which power spectrum goes like k to the 1 on large scales, so small k means 1 wavelength for large scales, turns over to k to the -3 on very small scales. When people talk about variant acoustic oscillations, that's these wiggles here, which are the same wiggles you see in the cosmic microwave background, except much smaller. Because here we're not seeing variants directly or part of the reason. You're seeing the weighted average of what was what variants the dark matter was doing at the time when you see CV. So this turnover scale gives you the K when the mode for entering the horizon at matter radiation quality. Okay, so I promised to do an overview of current surveys. It isn't actually very complicated. There's the Sloan Digital Sky Survey main galaxies, which are the million galaxy redshifts that Sloan set out to obtain. These are all at quite low redshift, like up to 0.1. And the volume is so small that, as a practical matter, they're not very useful for cosmology. And the same is true of the GPF survey. This is not much of an oversimplification, which leaves the Sloan luminous red galaxies, which were designed specifically picked out luminous galaxies which they can easily identify at high redshift, at relatively high redshift, higher than 0.1, but the typical redshift is 0.25. So this covers 10,000 square degrees and about a cubic inch parsec. They're relatively sparse though. There's about 80,000, roughly 80,000 of them. And that means that this density field is not, there's a lot of statistical noise. Could be sampled better or more constrained colors. Part of the reason they didn't really realize in their planet survey how this the relative importance of these two things. Future surveys, there's something called, this is going to be very fast, but if you want to Google these things, Google things I mentioned, you'll pretty much hit all of the relevant surveys. Wigglesy is a survey at the AO Omega Telescope in Australia. In some sense, maybe you could think of it as the successor to GPF. It started already, it's going to measure 1,000 square degrees, Z at 0.5 to 1. As there's a proposed and actually starting, although not fully funded yet, survey SDSS-3, which the large-scale structure part of that is called BOSS. And the basic idea is to go out and do a lot more of these luminous red galaxies. They can actually identify them in the previous Sloan imaging, and they just didn't target them. And there's some upgrades to the spectrograph, which make it easier go to higher redshift with ancient galaxies. So this will get out to 0.7 with a higher density. And it's started, the BOSS part, the large scale structure part, won't start until 2009. And it will run for about 5 years. There's also HEDX, which is at the Hobie Everly Telescope in Texas. 200 square degrees. This is specializing to high redshift, so 1.8, 3.8. Possibly, I don't think it's fully funded, but if it happens, it will be starting in the next few years. They're starting some tests now. In the further future, you might hear about WFMOS, which is the new name for what used to be called Chaos. It's supposed to be a 4,500 fiber spectrograph on the Subaru 8.2 meter starting in the mid-2010s if it happens. Certainly not guaranteed to happen. 2,000 square degrees. They're talking, although this stuff's not cast in stone, about a 2,000 square degree survey at Z+1, and then a higher redshift, smaller area. All of these things are optimized and focused on variant acoustic oscillations, which were those measuring the scale of those wiggles in the R spectrum. There's a proposed JDAM space mission. So this is the U.S. Go After Dark Energy Mission, Joint Dark Energy Mission, I guess. ADAPT, SNAP is SNAP's certainly the one that I think is the oldest and maybe talked about the most, but SNAP would focus on deep lensing and supernovae, not redshift surveys. ADAPT, which is, I guess, the PI is Chuck Bennett of the PI at WMAP, would be a competitor to SNAP, but this would be the galaxy redshift survey that happened. And they would go after, try to do most of the sky, so the sky has 40,000 square degrees, maybe 30,000 of them, from redshift 1 to 2. This covers, that's about 110 cubic feet of parsecs. So remember that what we have now is 1 cubic feet of parsec. There is a European Euclid mission, which is actually almost identical. So you may have heard this called SCES before. Euclid is now the proposed merger of SPACE, which is the Galaxy Redshift Survey, and DUNE, which was more of a deep lensing survey. And finally, I'm going to mention CHIME, which is a possible Canadian 21 centimeter survey, or this 21 centimeter could be done with SKA. So the bottom line of the 21 centimeter mission is just you're measuring emission from all neutral gas, treating it as a continuous field instead of trying to positively identify individual objects, because identifying individual objects is hard. This can work because we only care about large scales, where in any sort of Fourier modon scale we care about, there's a lot of objects, and we only care about the density of that, how many, the number of them there are, not actually identifying individual ones. These are essentially, this will be dominated essentially by damp line alpha systems. So you'll be measuring the large scale power spectrum of damp line alpha systems without actually identifying individual ones. And if it works, it will allow the equivalent of like that JDAM ADAPT level survey at orders of magnitude less cost. I got this slide from Zuchin, 21 centimeter, the 21 centimeter line. It's this hyperfine transition with neutral hydrogen at 21 centimeters, of course. Whaley has been working hard to prove that this can work. The problem is potentially foregones and other things like that. They've done some tests where they've cross-correlated galaxies with 21 centimeter intensity, and they have two different detections. This NNO very low redshift cross-correlation, and something that's in preparation, cross-correlation between GBT and the two galaxies at CO 0.9. And so they find basically the signal you expect, which isn't surprising. There's not much question that the signal would be there. We know that the damp line and alpha systems are out there, and we know that they should emit in 21 centimeter. So the only issue is whether or not you can actually remove foregrounds and do all of the instrumental details to high enough precision to do large scale structure. So they dodge these issues by cross-correlating. The galaxies won't have the foregrounds, so we cross-correlate galaxies with 21 centimeter. Even if there's some big foregrounds in the 21 centimeter, it'll wash out in the galaxies. I mean, in this cross correlation. And this is another slide from teaching on the CHIME, Canadian Hydrogen Intensity Mapping Experiment, which is, I guess, the PI is Mark Alvin at UBC. And they have been teaching for tonight. It would do about half the sky at a redshift 0.8 to roughly 2.5. And I'm not sure the exact numbers, but I believe it will do it for of order $10 million compared, and this is roughly the same as ADDUP, the JDEM would do for, 10 or 100 times as much. So now I'm going to get to the actual theory developments, which are all related to bias. So we can do, what does bias mean? We can do simple, accurate calculations of how mass clusters in the universe on large scales. But we can't really simulate galaxies with accuracy that's useful for precision cosmology. So for about the last two decades, our theory of galaxy clustering for the purpose of cosmological parameter estimation has been take the mass power spectrum, multiply it by a constant, or a constant squared, and that's the galaxy power spectrum. So V here is what we call the bias. This is the galaxy power spectrum. And I would say that attempts to go beyond this have been embarrassingly haphazard. But this has to change in the future, because these big high-precision surveys are not going to be tolerant of any inaccuracy of the modeling. One thing you should know about galaxy bias is this V factor is not the same for all galaxies. It depends on the type of galaxy, and particularly the mass of the halo that the galaxy is sitting. So here's an example. This shows shows the luminosity, the bias as a function of luminosity. High luminosity, which typically would be high mass, galaxies have a higher bias. Low luminosity have a low bias. And for a long time, we thought of bias more or less completely as a nuisance. But the interesting thing is, some of these developments actually make use of bias in a non-trivial way that you wouldn't be able to do things you couldn't do if you could just observe mass directly. Okay. So now I'm going to talk about galaxy clustering in models with non-Gaussian initial conditions. So inflation models predict nearly Gaussian initial perturbations, but maybe with some small deviations. And I'm going to talk about this form of non-Gaussianity, which is local. The curvature fluctuations are local in some Gaussian field, but so this phi is a Gaussian field. This is the curvature. So if there was none of this, then the perturbations would be Gaussian, but this nonlinear term makes the perturbations non-Gaussian. And the only term I'm really going to be talking about is the first one here, which is proportional to phi squared. Current constraints from WMAP on this F and L parameter, which measures the amplitude of the non-Gaussian energy, are here. It's consistent with zero. You can connect these curvature perturbations to large-scale structure observables, basically starting with the Poisson equation, so the Newtonian potential. Fourier's, the important thing to remember about these is in Fourier space, the density perturbations are on large scales proportional to k squared times the curvature perturbation squared. So the transfer function goes to 1 on large scales when k goes to 0. This means that the potential perturbations are large relative to the, are small relative to the density on small scales and relatively larger on large scales. So there, previous to recently, there's projections for how well future surveys can measure these FNL based on the bispectrum. So the Fourier transform of the three-point function. And Couret et al. Found that Planck could measure FNL to about 5. Adept should be able to measure FNL to about 3.6 from the bispectrum. And it was thought that the bispectrum, so it was thought that the bispectrum was the way to do this because I guess the power spectrum, the non-Gaussianity enters the power, doesn't enter the power spectrum at lowest order. It enters the power spectrum at higher order, and these perturbations are level 10 to the minus 5. So the reason, so for a Gaussian, remember the FNL term was proportional to phi squared, and delta is proportional. It's proportional to phi squared within delta. So at lowest order in the power spectrum, you just have the usual Gaussian thing. And then when you, you have to go to higher order than phi to find the non-Gaussian contribution. In the bispectrum, because so the bispectrum is the product of three deltas, the lowest order Gaussian part, essentially this is the definition of the Gaussian field, is zero. So the three phi's give zero. You need to insert one of those FNL phi squared pieces into this phi section to get something. So it's not zero. And gravity does the same thing. So it's lowest order in the bispectrum, higher order in the power spectrum. This is where this Dalal et al. Paper was so interesting, in that they showed that when you have a bias tracer, you get some contribution to the bias, which goes like k to the minus 2, and can become significant on very large scales. So k, as k goes to 0, this excess, this new contribution. And this has been confirmed for halos in various ways by several other people.
Does it depend on the model?
Yeah, this basic mechanism works for this local model.
Because if you can put it either in the initial potential or initial density.
Exactly what I said. The potential.
Yeah, but it's not necessarily universal for all models.
Right. This is what I'm talking about.
Right.
This version. This is what this. There's so. This is there's. There's been a small industry of working on this particular effect since it happened. Since their paper. Because it's so new and it seems to work so well. truth is, the reason that I'm talking about this is mostly, I wrote one paper on this, but the Celjak idea was motivated by this, but it's much more general than this, in that it's not just about non-Gaussianity. It can be used for, well, it can be used for lots of other things, like Ritchie space distortions. And well, anyway, there is a story that I'm supposed to be telling, which I'm not telling very well. Anyway, this is what this Dalal et al. Effect looks like. The dotted line is what the Carr spectrum would be for Gaussian image conditions. The solid line is some excess power from this non-Gaussian contribution. This is for some just specific example, redshift 0.75, initial Gaussian bias of 2, FNL of 5. This arrow marks the 2 pi, this is basically the minimum wave number that you can actually probe given the volume of the universe at 0.75. So this stuff's irrelevant, but this is just to show basically what you're trying to measure. It's a very large scale effect. And well, they cast this as a modification of the bias, just some scale dependent modification of the bias. I would say that a more clear way of writing it is just like this, to say that the galaxy density is some delta bias plus some phi bias times FNL times phi, where if you want to do those, it would be FNL over phi bias. But this is typically this phi bias is going to be proportional to FNL. So this is a fairly general form that doesn't rely on the halo model. If you have a halo model like Dalal et al. Or Sosa et al. Use, then you can calculate what should the numerical value of this E5 be, at least approximately. So typically it's of the same order as the order you need.
When you say delta bias and phi bias, you mean those are the factors that you would multiply the delta power spectrum or the phi power spectrum by, respectively, to get the galaxy spectrum?
I'm literally just delta galaxy. V delta is some number times delta, plus V phi times FNL, which are both just numbers. They could be one number.
Okay, then how are you separating? The way you're separating V phi and FNL is that FNL is defined by that earlier equation you showed?
Dalal et al would have written FNL here and not written it here. It's irrelevant. This is just suggested because you expect this V5 to be ordered 1 even if FNL is 100. Or if FNL could be 1 or 100, you still expect this V5 to be ordered 1.
Do you know if the usual inflation model, conservative inflation model, gives this type of multiple sharing to you?
No, I think not the most standard.
Okay, so this is very specific model of multiple sharing.
I'm not sure how general it is. It certainly is not general. I'm not sure how.
Because it's absolutely huge effect.
Well, if you calculate, so one thing I did in my paper, which I'm not, I have a paper on this, not that paper actually, this year paper, which I calculated in perturbation theory, the effect in the mass power, there is no effect, no measurable effect in the mass power spectrum. The high order terms are actually technically infinite, but you can just change the normalization of the initial perturbations and absorb that into that change.
But you cannot do it this in piece, so you have to type the normalization is tight.
No, the CMD, this is all at the curvature perturbation level. It's not, because a power spectrum just always has a convergence of one end or another, which is a problem once you start adding these nonlinear terms. But it's a non-issue for the. The surprising thing is that it actually does show up in the gas. And this, I don't even know how much time. An alarmingly large fraction of this talk got written today. I'm going to show where this comes from in the galaxy power spectrum in my perturbative bias way of looking at this. But I think that I'm not going to, because I don't have time, and the Seljak idea is more interesting. There's just a few months ago, Urs Seljak put out a paper where he had a very interesting idea for how to improve the measurement of particularly this FNL. But the real point of me talking about any of this is that this is more general than anything to do with non-Gaussian energy. Imagine you have two different types of galaxies with different bias. We have this kind of form for the relation between galaxy density and mass density. So relative to mass density, and I just put all of those factors, including k to the minus 2, in the C1 of k. So that would depend on the galaxy bias, the particular kind of galaxy bias too. And I divided an FNL. I mean, the B F tilde is actually FNL over B. If you look at relatively high k, so small scales, these terms go away. And if there were no noise, so you would observe two types of galaxies. And alpha here is just B of the second type of galaxy over B of the first type of galaxy. If you take the ratio of these and there's no noise, all you have what you're left with, the deltas, the mass density deltas, which are the random field, cancels out. And you have a measurement of the ratio of biases with no noise. Of course, if you have a finite number of galaxies, you're going to have some noise. But especially on larger scales near the turnover of the power spectrum, there's enough galaxies out there to get very high signal to noise measurements of these modes. So you can actually measure something like the ratio of the biases without any cosmic variance. Then, if you know that, and you know what the relative biases of these two types of galaxies are, you go to a smaller case, a larger scale, where this non-Gaussian effect kicks in, you can do the same thing again, where you take the effect is has different sizes for different types of galaxies. Like an unbiased type of galaxy will have essentially no effect, a no non-Gaussian effect, whereas a biased galaxy will have this upturn in power. You can take this ratio again and do the same thing again, where if there's no noise, you have this part still in that case, but you know this alpha, the ratio of the biases. So you can measure this ratio FNL over B to precision limited only by how good of signal to noise in the sampling of the field you can achieve. The primordial fluctuations cancel out.
Couldn't the alpha also be scale dependent?
That was a lot of what I skipped. Not on these scales, it should not be. There's fairly rigorous reasons to believe that the model, in the Gaussian case, the model delta G is some constant times delta should work. Well, that plus a shot noise term on large scales. So scales, well, scales like, you know, scales that we would usually think of as linear. But as long as you're careful enough, this particular FNL thing, which is sensitive to the largest scales, is a particularly good application for this because it is really so large. And what I skipped is the reason this is the reason I say there's a rigorous expectation that this model should work is related to my paper on renormalizing the galaxy bias, where I showed that if you write the galaxy density as a Taylor series in mass density, the linear bias model is just the first term in that Taylor series. If you calculate the higher order terms, they can in the power spectrum, say, in that, including the higher order bias terms in that Taylor series, they can be large. But the form, their form, their asymptotic form as k goes to zero will always look like either white shot noise or this kind of linear bias. So those higher terms can renormalize these parameters you already had, but they don't introduce new k dependents. And you just have to look at it. That just comes out of the equations. Anyway, we also have simulations which show that this works as basically to the accuracy we can test for those simulations on large scales. Celtex, group tests, new simulations that are coming out, which do start to show deviations from these linear theory calculations as you go to relatively high k, which we would have expected.
So this is in what simulations?
With halos. I mean, Neil Galal et al. Had simulations. But so what the remarkable thing is, he showed that you can measure FNL tilde, which is FNL over E, with essentially no cosmic variance. It's your noise. These X's here are the noise power for type of galaxy IJ over their just general linear theory power. And these can go to zero. So your measurement of FNL over V can be arbitrarily precise. Now, what you might think, well, there's that V in there, and that's the usual galaxy bias problem. Have we really gained anything? And if we wanted to measure FNL itself very precisely, that would be a problem. But if all you care about is whether, you know, FNL is 10, 1, 0.1, you can estimate V to factor of 2, say, and that uncertainty is not a problem in this for this initial just detection limit. Once you, if you detected this effect, then you worry about what is the value of p and what does that tell us about precisely what the FNL is. So this is a calculation I actually did. Irish did sort of a back of the envelope level calculation of how well this would work, and I did a more careful calculation for this Euclid satellite. This is the FNL, literally FNL inverse FNL sort of squared error as a function of the K max you can use. And should reduce the number of lines to plots, but this top black line is basically what you expect to be able to do from this survey without this approach, just looking at these galaxies as a single type of galaxy. And you could get to FNL of about 2.2. The green line should have been looking at the lower black line. The lower green line is what you can do if you just split the galaxies in Euclid in half. high and low bias half, you get about a factor of, almost a factor of two improvement in your FNL constraint. And you might say, well, a factor of two, who cares about that? But one thing to remember is, if you're, this is an all-sky survey, there isn't any more universe out there. So if you can double an error, if you can reduce an error by a factor, bar by a factor of two, that's like quadrupling the volume that you're measuring, because the errors go like the square root of the volume. So you've like made the universe four times bigger if you can reduce an error by a factor of two. Blue here is, so this is studying the galaxy in half, but one thing about these surveys like this that are variant acoustic oscillation calibrated is they're designed to sort of not make this test work very, this self-jab method work very well, because they're designed to have only the minimum necessary signal to noise to do EAO. If you can add an unbiased tracer that had a much higher density in addition to the Euclid galaxies, you go up again to this to blue curves, which correspond to an FNL of about 0.7. And so this kind of 21 centimeter mapping could provide this second very high precision field. Cyan here is if you took a perfect unbiased field and the second bias field had 10 times the Euclid number density. So the Euclid number density is something like 0.002 galaxies per cubic megaparsec, which there's a lot more galaxies than that out there. So there's no reason you can't do better in the long run. The 21 centimeter method could actually provide both fields also. In any case, if you had this better survey, you could get down to FNL 0.2. And I will stop because it's been too long. But the new, more general useful thing that you can do with this is redshift is measure redshift space distortion this way. So the power spectrum in redshift space for some type of galaxy eyes, Kaiser, 1980 something, calculated in linear theory looks like this. It's the bias times 1 plus this beta parameter times u squared times the mass density perturbations, where u squared is the angle between the wave vector in your line of sight. So mu is 1 for a mode along your line of sight. They're enhanced by these computer velocities, and 0 transverse to your line of sight. There is no computer velocities. Beta is f over v over bias, where the bias, where f is d log growth factor, d log a. And you can see, if you understood the discussion of FNL, you can see where this is going. Where if you take, say you have two different kinds of galaxies, and you look at modes transverse to line of sight where mu is 0, you can measure the ratio of those two types of galaxies' biases with precision limited not by cosmic variance, but only by your number density. Then you can turn around these modes that are radial, and you can measure this redshift space distortion parameter with, again, accuracy that's only limited by your number density. The problem with this that makes it not quite as, in some sense, not quite as exciting as the FNL version is you don't care about detecting beta. Beta you expect to be something, this parameter you expect to be something like 0.5, and you know, we've measured it roughly for some galaxy surveys. The interesting thing is measuring this d log d log a very precisely, because this could constrain dark energy evolution as a function of redshift. But so you can measure beta with arbitrary precision, but that's not 100% exciting. What you can show is that this, if you work through the Fisher matrix calculation entirely, you can show that what measuring, having measured beta allows you to do, perfectly allows you to do, is measure effective F squared times the mass power spectrum, which entered, so I wrote, rewrote this usual redshift space distortion in a different form here, which is kind of more direct. You're really talking about some density, bias times density fluctuations, plus some just bias unrelated redshift distortion part. And this, so you can measure the power spectrum of this part is essentially the velocity divergence power spectrum, which, like when Max Tegmark does his STSS galaxy power spectrum analysis, he actually uses these redshift space distortions to separate the bias effect and the velocity divergence power spectrum effect. But it's very, the measurement of this divergence power spectrum is very, is not very precise because of the need to marginalize over the bias, and imprecise enough to make it not useful. What this multi-tracer method does is lets you measure this velocity divergence power spectrum in the limit of perfect signal to noise, as well as you could measure the velocity divergence power spectrum if you could see velocity divergence directly, which you can't. And you can derive how much better that is for a typical beta of like 0.5. That's like 50 times better in fractional error squared on the velocity power spectrum. So 7 times better in RMS error. So a huge, huge improvement on how well you can measure the velocity divergence power spectrum. And I need to stop. But you can work through various other Fisher matrix calculations to get to cosmological parameters. And this shows the dark energy task force figure of merit, which is, you can just think of as a measure of how well you're constraining the dark energy equation of state. As a function of the maximum redshift of a survey, and the really important thing to look at here is these blue lines are baryon acousticals. If the survey was a galaxy survey and you're just using baryon acoustic oscillations, the green lines are if you add this, add all the information in the velocity divergence power spectrum, but also things like Alcock-Kaczynski, what I call geometric effects, and didn't explain very well. Add all of that, you get a lot of information right there from just that extra stuff that you usually don't include in these forecasts for how useful these surveys are. Like really an order of magnitude for a big survey in improved figure of merit. Which again, so the figure of merit's nice in that if you took your all of your data and like the volume of a survey, the figure of merit and doubled the volume, the figure of merit would double. So you can think of this as interchangeable with volume. Although it's actually better than that because things like the Planck CMB satellite are included in this, and you can't double Planck because it's again CMB. And the black lines are what you are gains as a function of signal to noise using this multi-tracer method. So the first line is one, signal to noise of 1, 3, 10, 30, 100, and 1,000. And which is completely unrealistic, but it's here actually to show that when you include the Alcock-Kaczynski type things in addition to velocity dispersed, redshift space distortion, you actually have no bound on the constraining power. You can break that final degeneracy. And so you're a lot better than varying acoustic oscillations. The red lines here are what you would, so the baseline, the the figure of merit is Planck plus sort of things that are going on now, like CFHT legacy survey lenses. These red lines are what you would get if you added the LSST lensing or SNAP lensing to that baseline. So you get about a factor of 10 improvement, which is what the Dark Energy Task Force was talking about as the goal for stage 4. Red is if you then add those lensing surveys to this lowest green line. So this stuff works, which it's optimistic, but the 21 centimeter idea has made me optimistic. It kind of renders these green lensing surveys obsolete. And I'll stop.
If we don't have immediate questions, we continue in the coffee room. Thank you.